Is your dog getting a little extra junk in the trunk? Well, if so, stay tuned. Today we're going to talk about obesity in the dog. I'm Dr. Megs, and this is Everyday Vet. Obesity is defined as being 15 to 20% or more higher than the optimal weight. And this is definitely an increasing concern in our dog populations. You know, I see it on a regular basis. People come in with their dogs and they're really good at recognizing if their dog is underweight, but determining that the dog is overweight is where we often fall a little short. So if you haven't checked out my episode yet on body condition scoring, I would recommend that you pop over to that video, take a look at it, kind of give your dog its own little score on the body condition scoring scale, and then pop back over to this video. Because in order to assess for obesity and monitor any improvement, we need to be able to be looking at your specific dog and knowing where its body condition lies. So this is a very important health concern for dogs, though. You know, it does impact their overall longevity even. And there are a lot of health impacts, too, for this. It's been found, actually, that dogs that are obese can even have a reduction in their lifespan by as much as 2 years. And this is really significant, especially if we're looking at our large breed dogs, because some of them have an average lifespan of 10 to 13 years even. And if you're taking 2 years off of a dog that would have otherwise lived 10 years, that's 20% of their lifespan. Now, as far as what things that we can see with their overall health, one of the most common problems that I address in dogs especially is orthopedic disease. So this could be in terms of any injury or arthritis even. So dogs that are prone to getting arthritis will likely develop arthritis anyways, but if we keep the weight off of them, they actually tend to develop arthritis later on in life. So they get a longer duration of those less pain years, and that has a really big impact on their overall quality of life. It really improves their mobility a lot too. So we really want to make sure that we're not putting too much weight on their joints. And the other thing that we can see with dogs that have too much weight is actually getting these tears to their cranial cruciate ligament. That's basically the dog version of the human ACL. And this really kind of, you know, it goes deeper than just the orthopedic problem, because if they have a tear to this ligament, then a lot of times it actually requires surgery to fix. But one of the other complications we see with obesity in dogs is anesthetic complications. So anytime you put a dog under anesthesia, the medications that we're using to induce anesthesia and maintain them under that anesthetic plane actually will depress their heart system and their breathing system. And if they have extra weight on their body in general, their lungs and all of their muscles have to work a lot harder to kind of get that air into their system. So they're already going to be at a higher strain on their heart and their lungs to begin with. And then we add in these medications to keep them under anesthesia, and we're really straining their body a lot. And we can definitely run into anesthetic complications with it, which could actually be life-threatening even. So when it comes to obesity and orthopedic problems, you know, we're putting that strain on the joint and causing the orthopedic problem, but then we might also be putting them in too high of an anesthetic risk complication to even be able to fix the problem. And then, assuming that we actually are able to proceed with the surgery to fix the problem, you then run into the issue of recovery. So anytime your dog has any kind of orthopedic issue, it will likely need to be put under exercise restriction. That way you're not moving those joints too much, and that way we can allow the tendons and everything to heal. But if your dog is already morbidly obese or overweight even, getting the weight off of them while they're not really allowed to move around a whole lot is really hard. And the extra weight is actually going to put a ton of weight on those joints. So it's not just one problem or another. All of these things kind of interact with each other. And then, you know, kind of another layer on top of that is it's actually been shown that dogs that have, you know, this obesity problem do have an increase in overall pain. So you compound that with maybe orthopedic issues and possibly even needing surgery and anesthetic complications, we're really delving quite deep into an overall huge impact on their quality of life and ability to recover from anything. So in addressing obesity in the dog, we first have to understand why the dog is obese in the first place. So it might be something as simple as too much food intake, or it could actually be due to an underlying medical concern. So one thing that I do see fairly commonly, at least in dogs, is called hypothyroidism. That's when the thyroid levels in the body are too low, and that has this impact on basically most of the body. So it's really important that if your dog is overweight, you get it checked out by a veterinarian, make sure that there's no underlying medical concerns before you just start making adjustments to their food. So with hypothyroidism, we actually see changes in their overall exercise level. They can be lethargic, so not really have as much energy, and they won't want to exercise as much. We also see that they tend to be gaining weight despite a lack of an increase in their food. So this can be definitely very frustrating for owners. You know, you might be looking at your dog and say, hey, my dog's overweight, I'm going to reduce its food. And then the dog still has weight gain anyways. And that's, you know, if there's hypothyroidism going on, that's going to happen unless we treat the hypothyroidism. So other things that hypothyroidism can actually do in the body too are primarily skin changes. So in as many as 60 to 80% of the dogs with hypothyroidism, we actually see them getting this thinning coat or even bald areas. So what can happen with them is they can actually start shedding excessively. So you'll see them really losing a ton of their fur, and the hair regrowth is actually very delayed. So they're losing the fur, but their body's not really making more fur production. So you might look at a dog and see like this overall thinner hair coverage, or you might see actual areas that don't have much hair at all. So that could definitely be a sign of underlying hypothyroidism. But other things it can do are even affect the neurologic system. Again, that's not very common, but that can certainly happen. And that could be really serious. We want to make sure that your dog's not having, losing its ability to kind of get up and walk around and everything. Another less common problem we can see is changes to the eye. So one of the things that it can do is actually affect the tear production. And if the eye is not producing enough tear film, it's not getting enough protection over that corneal layer, and you might see an increase in friction with eyelids on the actual cornea itself, and that can cause a lot of problems for the eye. So for further information on the eye, make sure that you check out the video that I did on how to perform a little mini physical exam. I showed how to take a look at the eyes and what general changes might indicate. So if you're seeing a problem in your dog's eyes, definitely pop over to that video and check it out. But eye problems really aren't common with hypothyroidism, although they can technically occur. Now, other things we can see, again, not common, is upset stomach. So they can actually see constipation with hypothyroidism, but again, that's not common. So overall, the top things that we see in a dog with hypothyroidism are going to be those changes in energy level. So the dog's maybe a lot less active than it used to be, or also gaining weight despite a lack of food intake. And that can be really frustrating if you're trying to get your dog to lose weight. So if you're seeing any of these things, make sure that you get your dog looked at by the veterinarian so that way they can treat it, because hypothyroidism is actually very treatable. There's like a little oral medication that they take it by mouth, and it's just to supplement the thyroid hormone. So it's pretty simple to treat, but the key is actually making sure that we're finding it in the first place. Now, if we rule out underlying medical concerns as the cause for the obesity, then we typically move on to dietary management. And it's really important that you do this under the guidance of a veterinarian, because we don't want to simply cut back on overall food intake. We want to actually do it in a very controlled way, so that way your dog's not losing out on nutrition. Because, you know, yes, we want to restrict calories, but we don't want to restrict the other nutrients going into your dog. And we definitely don't want to cause any deficiencies there. So for example, I've seen foods that have, you know, even like, well, for Hades, for example, I'm actually working on switching him right now. So the food that he was on had over 400 calories in each cup of food. The food that he's going to be on now has around 320 calories. So that's a very big difference. And by doing that, I can actually still give him the amount of cups that he needs in order to get the rest of his nutritional value, but it's not going to be as calorically dense, so that way he's going to be less inclined to put extra weight on. Now, there are definitely over-the-counter diets that can help for your dog, particularly the light formulations. I know Hill's Science Diet actually makes an adult light formula as well as a large breed light formula. They also have a perfect weight formula. I find that their diets in general are really good, and that might be something that you want to consider. I'm not sponsored by any means by them, but I do like a lot of their products. But in some of the more advanced cases, if your dog is just really obese overall and we really need to get that weight off of them, your veterinarian will likely recommend doing a prescription diet. these diets are prescription because we don't want to do extreme calorie restriction in a dog that's otherwise healthy. So in order to get these, you do need a prescription diet. And the idea behind it is that it's being offered by a veterinarian to treat a medical condition, and it's being fed under medical supervision. So weight loss is something that we definitely want to do in a controlled manner. Like I said, we don't want to cause nutritional deficiencies. So it is really important that you're doing it under the guidance of the veterinarian. And by switching to the prescription diets, you can actually do it in a safer, more controlled way and usually get faster results. The other thing that I really like about some of the prescription diets is you might be able to address a couple of concerns together. So I know before we mentioned, the serious impact that obesity can have, especially on joint disease. Well, there is actually a prescription diet out there. It's called Hill's Metabolic Plus Mobility. Again, I'm not sponsored by Hill's, but I do like their products. And it's actually meant to treat for their weight gain and get that weight off of them. But it's got that plus mobility aspect. So they're also treating the joint disease that your dog might have as well. So that way you're kind of doing a dual approach at keeping your dog overall comfortable and happy. So definitely want to check out with your veterinarian if there's something else going on with your dog or what you can do from a nutritional standpoint to keep them healthy. Now, the other thing that we really have to take into consideration with dogs, and I think this is actually probably the most important part about dog obesity, is a lot of times pets become overweight because of the bond that we have with them. So there's this huge propensity for owners to want to feed their dogs extra because dogs love food. And if you give them treats and you give them extra food, the dog is happy. And it has been found that dogs that are overweight actually maybe even have an increased bond with their owners, like increased sleeping on the bed and just overall increased interaction. And I think that's really important for dogs to have that experience with their owners. And I definitely don't want to take that away. You know, it's really important to get that weight loss off of the dog, but not at the sacrifice of the bond that you have with them and the overall happiness of the dog. Because yes, a dog that's eating is a happy dog, and I don't want to take that away. So there are a lot of things that we can do for that. So for instance, you know, doing that prescription diet to get the weight off can help you give them the food that you want to give them, but without them getting so many calories in. But there are also some easier steps that you can take too. So a lot of times when dogs come in that are obese, they are getting a lot of maybe human food even, or a lot of treats at home. And I find that this is a big area for them to gain weight because we don't often realize how many extra calories we're putting into them with these treats and human foods. So keep in mind, just a general rule of thumb, from the daily amount of calories that your dog gets, you want at least 90% of that to come from their actual dog food and only 10% or less coming from treat, whether that be, an actual dog treat or whether that be like table scraps or something like that. So in order to make sure that you're still able to give them treats but without overdoing it on the calorie content, there are actually some human foods that you can give them that are very safe and lower in calorie. I really like to recommend carrots, celery, and green beans even. Those are really nice, healthy alternatives. And depending on the dog, they might love them. So Zeus, for example, absolutely loves carrots. He thinks it's the best thing in the world. He actually likes the carrots better than his dog treats. So I find that by doing that, I get to give him his treat and I have that really good bonding moment with him, but I'm not sacrificing his overall health. It's a really healthy snack and I'm not getting a lot of calories into him, and I can do that pretty much as I want to, but I'm not causing him to be obese because of it. So I'm not sacrificing his overall longevity and, you know, his mobility with his joints and everything. I'm not sacrificing that, but I am still getting that really high value bonding experience with him. And I think that's really important that you get to do that at home.
So in conclusion, obesity has some serious health implications for your dog, so it's really important that you get him in to see the veterinarian in order to start managing your dog's weight, as well as to check for any underlying conditions that might be making the problem worse, such as hypothyroidism. But all in all, we want to make sure that through this, we're maintaining that good bond that you have with your dog through the use of healthy treats instead. So if you'd like to leave me a comment below, I'd appreciate it if you could let me know which of the healthy snacks your dog likes best. Also, if you have any tips or tricks that worked particularly well at getting your dog to a healthy weight, please let us know. I'm sure that everyone here will find that useful. Also, don't forget to subscribe to my channel so that way you don't miss out on any videos. And don't forget to check out that body condition scoring episode 2. That'll be really helpful in managing your dog's weight through this. Well, that's about it for today. Don't forget to like the video below. I'm Dr. Megs, and this is Everyday Vet.